your takeaways from our discussion about what statistical significance really means should be that, one, there is nothing magical about alpha equals 0.05. Two, a p-value does not tell us enough. And C, we should report effect sizes and confidence intervals with our findings. An effect size is a standardized measure of the size of an effect. It measures how large the effect was, allowing for the objective evaluation of the size of the effect. So effect size helps us answer the question of whether a treatment had any practical usefulness. How big was the effect? Cohen's D is the most commonly used measure of effect size for t-tests. So how is effect size different than significance? Well, statistical significance tells us that differences between means were not due to chance, or at least probably not due to chance. Statistical significance measures the probability that we would find the results that we found if the null hypothesis was true, which we know that it never truly is. And making decisions based on p-values can be very misleading. Consider the following example from Rosnow and Rosenthal. Smith conducts an experiment with a sample size of 80, comparing the effects of two leadership styles on productivity. Smith finds that style A is better than style B. Jones is skeptical, because Jones created style B. So, he replicates Smith's study with a sample size of 20. Smith's original study had a T of 2.21, 78 degrees of freedom, P less than 0.05. Jones reports a failure to replicate. His T-value was 1.06, 18 degrees of freedom, P greater than 0.30. Now, it is true that Jones did not replicate Smith's p-value. But let's consider the Cohen's D effect size. Smith's D was a 0.49. Jones's D was a 0.47. The magnitude of the effect obtained by Jones was almost identical to the effect obtained by Smith. Jones had found exactly what Smith had found, even though the two p-values were not very close. Because of using a small sample size, Jones's study was not very powerful, but the non-significant results implied that there was no real effect. Not true. Smith's power, because of his sample size of 80, was more than 3 times greater, and the effect size shows us that each study found the same effect regardless of p-values. Jacob Cohen gives us conventions for interpreting Cohen's D effect size: small, medium, and large. And already you may be questioning, where do these numbers come from? I mean, didn't Fisher use 0.05 because it was convenient? Why should we accept these suspiciously round-numbered conventions from Cohen? Well, if you think these conventions are arbitrary, Jacob Cohen would agree with you. He wrote, "All conventions are arbitrary. One can only demand of them that they not be unreasonable." And then Cohen went on to explain why these conventions are reasonable, or at least useful. They are based on probabilities. Consider that we are comparing two distributions, representing group 1 and group 2. When the mean difference is 0, and therefore D equals 0, there is 100% overlap in the distributions. Each mean is higher than 50% of its own distribution. That is what the mean is, the point that is higher than 50% of the lower half of the distribution. So, because there is 100% overlap, each mean is also higher than 50% of the other distribution. But as one mean starts to diverge, the mean difference, the difference between those upright bars, becomes greater, And so D becomes larger. Remember that D is the standardized difference between the means. So as the means diverge, there is also less overlap of the distributions. So for example, when D equals 0.1, there is a 7.7% non-overlap of the two distributions. They overlap except for about 8%. Small effect sizes can be measured, but their differences are not visible to the naked eye. So when D equals 0.2, there is a 14.7% non-overlap, and mean 2 is higher than 57.9% of the first distribution. Remember, it started at 50%. Cohen says that in new fields of study, effects are likely to be small because the measurements are imprecise. So if you are researching something that is not well understood, assume that you are looking for small effect sizes on the magnitude of 0.2 or 0.3. Cohen says that there is a small effect size difference between the average heights of 15 and 16-year-old girls. So if you were to look at a classroom of 15 and 16-year-old girls mingled together, it would be very difficult to see who is who. A medium effect size is large enough to be seen with the naked eye. So when D equals 0.5, there is a 33% non-overlap. Mean 2 is higher than 69.1% of the first distribution. There is a medium effect size for height difference between 14 and 18-year-old girls. So if you have a classroom of 14 and 18-year-old girls mingled together, you should be relatively easily able to tell who is 14 and who is 18 by their height. Cohen says that there is a medium effect size difference in IQ between clerical and semi-skilled workers, or between professional versus managerial occupations. A large effect size is easily seen. When D equals 0.8, there is a 47.4% non-overlap, almost 50%, and mean 2 is higher than 78.8% of the first distribution. There is a large effect of height difference between 13 and 18-year-old girls. Look at a classroom of 7th graders mixed with high school seniors, and you should have no trouble separating them. Cohen describes a large effect as the difference in IQ between PhD holders and typical college freshmen. If there is a large effect size in your data, you should be able to see it by looking at the raw data. Another researcher expanded Cohen's conventions to include very small at 0.1, very large at 1.2, and huge at 2.0. I hope that you can see that Cohen's conventions, while still arbitrary, are not at all unreasonable. And don't get hung up on categorizing a difference of D of 0.78 as medium or large. It is what it is, and it can be directly interpreted. When we know the effect size, we can figure out how many people that we would need in our experiment to find an effect of that size. And this is called a power analysis. It helps us choose a large enough sample that we are likely to find any differences that exist, and to not miss effects, and to waste time and money, by having too few participants. Recall the Smith and Jones leadership study. If we do not know the effect size, we could use our literature review to find a similar study and calculate the effect size, or we can make an educated guess. Cohen says that this is the advantage of using D for power analysis, that it need not be calculated. It can be posited directly. This is actually the strength of using D. What do you anticipate the differences to be? If you think that the differences will be small, then pick a D around 0.2 or 0.3. If you think the differences will be large, pick a D near 0.8. For medium, go with 0.5. then you can conduct your power analysis and discover the power of your test to find effects. So why should we report effect size? Well, several reasons. The first, and certainly not the least important, is that the APA recommends it. The APA recommends that all published statistical reports include a measure of effect size, even for statistically non-significant findings. Well, why else? In the video about what statistical significance really means, I showed an example of a research project using a certain kind of padding for hip replacement patients and how it reduced the incidence of bed sores to zero. I pointed out that statistics were not necessary to interpret this result. We can all see that the incidence has dropped to zero. So in cases like this, where you're not trying to generalize from a sample to a population, then null hypothesis statistical testing is unnecessary. If the research is exploratory or focused on your particular project, don't bother with p-values, just report the effect size. Now, when the sample size is small, null hypothesis statistical testing confuses non-significance with the absence of an effect. Remember how Jones suggested that failure to replicate Smith's study implied that Smith had been wrong in his criticism of Jones's program. And statistically non-significant results can be very important in the real world. When sample size is small and the results are non-significant, that does not necessarily mean that a treatment was wholly ineffective, especially when the direction of change is in the direction that you predicted. In other words, if a drug is halting deterioration in patients, but the t-test is not statistically significant, the drug is still promising. Report the effect size so that we know what kinds of improvement the drug is making. And finally, statistical significance is a function of sample size. In fact, simply increasing sample size can make non-significant findings shift to statistical significance. Effect size helps us to interpret probabilities in light of sample size. So if you are doing a research project with 2,000 middle school students about their attitudes on some educational program they have just received, every test will be statistically significant, even if the effect size is trivial, because you have an overpowered study. Because even the tiny, inconsequential shifts will be statistically significant, report the effect size so that we know how the education program is actually working. In short, there is no reason why you should fail to report an effect size.